Welcome, hello, and welcome to today's Tuesday talk. For those of you who don't know me, I am Leslie Levy. I am the executive director of the International Quilt Museum located at the University of Nebraska in Lincoln. The Quilt Museum proudly stewards and exhibits the world's largest collection of quilts and related textiles. Our collection spans 5 centuries in over 50 countries. As we create a global audience and collection that appreciates the artistic and cultural significance of quilts, it's with great delight that we get to work with artists and makers like today's guest, Amy Meisner. Before we begin, I wanted to recognize and thank those other organizations that partner with us to present Tuesday talks each week. So a shout out to the Modern Quilt Guild, the Quilt Alliance, the San Jose Museum of Quilts and Textiles, Surface Design Association, and SAQUA. Of course, our Tuesday talks would not be possible without the generous support of our sponsors. So I would like to thank Arafil, Artistic Artifacts, CNT Publishing, Empty Spools Seminars, eQuilter.com, Handy Quilter, Misty Fuse, Moda Fabric and Supplies, Nine Patch Fabrics, Quilt Mania, Schiffer Publishing, and The Quilt Show. Just a couple housekeeping reminders. I would ask that you put your questions that you want me to ask Amy in the Q&A function, if you don't mind. That way, as you all know, our chat gets so busy and has so much traffic that it's hard to be able to figure out what those questions are. So put your questions in the Q&A function and we will answer those at the end of Amy's presentation. Again, this is being recorded and it will be available on the IQM website and the IQM YouTube channel, as well as the channel for the textile talks on YouTube, where you can also see all of our previous textile talks. So if there's any that you've missed, I would encourage you to go and check those out as well. You can see Amy on screen with me. We are absolutely delighted to have her with us today. For those of you who have not met or may not be familiar with the work of today's guest, Amy Meisner is an Alaska artist who combines traditional handwork, found objects, and abandoned textiles to reference the literal, physical, and emotional work of women. Amy's social practice centers on fostering a repair culture by teaching clothing and textile repair as an act of prolonging, care, and accompaniment of vulnerable objects in transition. Amy holds undergraduate degrees in both art and textiles, an MFA in creative writing, and is currently a Northern Research Lab Fellow at the Anchorage Museum, researching Northern repair culture, congruent with graduate work in critical craft studies at Warren Wilson College in North Carolina. Amy and I met 5 years ago when SAQUA and the International Quilt Museum had a joint conference here in Lincoln. It's hard to believe it was that long ago, but it was a delight to meet you, and we've obviously been a big fan of your work since. So we are here today with you to talk about your upcoming exhibition at the Quilt Museum. It is called Sample Home, Wall Work by Amy Meisner. It opens February 20th and will be at the Quilt Museum through June 27th. So fingers crossed that people get their vaccinations and things open up and people can travel and come and visit and see your work in person. So welcome, Amy. We are absolutely delighted to visit with you today.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Leslie, for that introduction. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen right now and talk a little bit about my work. Thumbs up, Leslie, if you can see that.
Perfect.
Super. And thank you also to Laura Chapman for your communication and the technical prowess and work behind the scenes to put this together. I so appreciate it. And thank you as well to all of these entities who've come together to make this series possible. Such a powerhouse within the world of textiles. And yes, we are in a pandemic, but how great that we can connect in this way. I have so much gratitude for the groundwork you've all laid that makes it possible for the rest of us to share our work. So thank you. Thank you to the International Quilt Museum for the opportunity to show a selection of work in this collection I've titled Sample Home. And in many ways, I could endlessly reconfigure my work and still retain this title. My entire practice is an investigation of home life, a mosaic of the many visible and invisible homes I've encountered working with vintage textiles and fragmented narratives. These are histories that exist in the margins. The selection of work I'm sharing today is in the exhibition, but some of it is not, so it's a mix. So I'm presenting from my own home in what is now called Anchorage, a place name that's only around 110 years old. And it's important to acknowledge this short history and what a privilege it is to live on Dena'ina Echlena, Dena'ina homeland, a place holding a much longer and deeper history where families have raised children and cared for the land for thousands of years. For this stewardship, I am grateful and humbled. I've lived here for 20 years, the longest I've lived anywhere, and it's impossible for me to talk about my work without expressing a connection and bond to place. This is an affectation that 50 years ago, Yi Fu Tuan named topophilia. And I feel this despite long winters and despite the fact that in a larger alternative point of view, I'm an uninvited guest here. This is an important reframing because as a guest in someone else's homeland, you do well to check your behavior. I have a responsibility to acknowledge this as well as engage in my own manners of care and stewardship, which I'll talk about shortly. I also can't talk about my work without prodding at personal history, some of which takes place in a different, equally winter dark homeland that is not mine, but still lives inside me. This photo represents four generations of women on my mother's side, and I'm the child in this picture. And I always include this image when I discuss my practice, mostly as a reminder to myself. I am the 12th firstborn daughter to a firstborn daughter, a history that stretches back to the 1640s. This is the landscape of memory I stand on in all its messiness and misunderstandings and misremembering. It is as deep as it is wide. So full disclosure, I don't come from a family of quilters. There's not one woman in my Scandinavian family who thought it was a good idea ever to cut up perfectly good fabric into small pieces just to sew it all back together again. Theirs was the work of accretion, embroidery, crochet, garment construction, weaving, and constant mending. I sometimes wonder if the idea of intentionally cutting up something whole into something smaller just to reconfigure it felt like backwards momentum to them. There would have already been so many disruptions on a Swedish farm that the risk of leaving something unfinished was probably too high. And I will admit there is something more intimidating about a pile of small pieces of fabric than there is about a spool of mercerized cotton and a single crochet hook. Plus, there was just so much mending all the time. So the third component to share about my work is a specific choice of materials, often discarded or abandoned, created by women whose histories are lost to time and distance. And while I watched doilies bloom in my mormor's hands when I was a child, and we visited the farm in Sweden, or she visited us in the States, they weren't my first choice for a 13th birthday present, or an 11th, or a 16th. This is a complicated accretion of my own with complicated feelings I still tap into. Several years ago, I confronted this head on and crowdsourced vintage linens for 13 months from friends, strangers, people cleaning out their closets. I offered to become the final inheritor. And these are the materials and narratives that continue to inform my work. A friend recently, sort of delicately, asked if I felt trapped by this old cloth. And the answer was no, at least not right now. Where materials, place, and personal history converge is my stance, my footprint, what on the surface might seem tedious or mundane. And I think about that word a lot, mundane, which is derived from the Latin mundus, which means world. Another reframing, directly above the mundane is the super mundane, a word for the otherworldly, and below is the infra mundane, its dark opposite, a balancing of the beautiful and terrible. And this informs process. I'm an artist with a craft-based practice, a melding of embodied knowledge and conceptual discourse. For me, the questions aren't about art versus craft. They're about how to listen and observe, how to understand materials, how to keep showing up, how to place scraps from the margins into the center. I live in a precarious northern landscape. Talk to anyone who's lived here for a handful of years and they will tell you the snow, the ice is different. It's really obvious that it's not the same as it used to be. So not only do I feel topophilia, that connection to place, I also understand solastalgia, which is a yearning and a sorrow for a climate that once was. Much of my thinking happens during long winter walks, some of which are the same damn walk every day, or during our summer trash work in Prince William Sound, completely unplugged and out in the middle of what feels like nowhere. Here I observe change, collect imagery, but also objects, which I'll talk about in a minute. These images here are a series of photos of small melted holes I kept seeing in the forest one day, which reminded me of polynyas, which are unfrozen seawater in pack ice. And they're black and they absorb the heat and they make the ice melt further. Here they're juxtaposed with another repetition, stones from a remote Alaskan beach. I'm always turning over and collecting emotions as well. So this is a detail from a piece in the exhibition Sample Home, currently or almost currently at the International Quilt Museum. These yo-yo forms are made from bridal satin, which was purchased in the 1960s and given to me as full yardage. But this was yardage that was never used to make that wedding gown. Embedded inside are flat slate stones, and you'll recognize the light absorbing quality and the repetition from the previous slide. Cherry is double-sided and punctured. All of my work is about women's work, work of the body, literal work done by hand, and emotional labor. I keep thinking I actually need to update my artist statement, but this is the work I continue making. Cherry is about a loss of innocence, drawing from literal truth, emotional truth, fiction, nonfiction, relatable circumstances or not. It's constructed from unused bridal satin and cloth originally embroidered. That border is the border of a tablecloth. Other objects are crocheted and likely were encountered daily by unknown women. Cherry is a reimagining, a re-remembering, a misremembering, a chaos of lines and scribbles layered over the insistence of perfection. The work is very heavy, literally, like a trap, but also like armor, a duality echoed in the piece's reversibility. Because my choice of materials I'm constantly thinking about repair and an ethics of care. My social practice fosters a repair culture where I live by teaching mending. And I spend a lot of time repairing elderly textiles that literally crumble in my hands. Often, this is an accompaniment to their literal end. We as a family have a personal commitment to care and tending by cleaning remote beaches every summer in Prince William Sound. This is impossible, never-ending, and invisible repair work. Here is my son when he was about 8 with a steel cable. And needless to say, it's still there. Without a torch and a bigger boat, there is no way we could remove this. But we visit this beach, we call it Nemesis Beach, every couple of years when the conditions are safe. It's a difficult anchorage, and a lot of remote beaches in Alaska are. And every time we return, I worry we'll find something dead tangled in that mess. One year we witnessed a huge marine bird die off. I think they were shearwaters whose food source had dived too deep looking for colder water. And the kids called out every time they found a starved carcass on the beach. The first 5 birds were heartbreaking, but at a count of 45, I finally asked the kids to stop the tally because as future change makers, I didn't want them and I don't want them desensitized to death. This is an image of my husband sorting trash after about an hour of cleaning, a fraction of what we haul, which is mostly plastic, ghost net, packing materials. But this is the kind of personal, solitary, environmental practice that keeps my own consuming and making in check. I am absolutely aware of the materials I'm using, where they came from, what new object I'm bringing into the world, and why I would even do such a thing. So somebody might ask, so I'll go ahead and answer now. No, I don't make work out of beach trash. There is nothing worse than picking up a piece of styrofoam and having it explode into a billion pieces in the rocks. That, along with finding capped water bottles full of chewing tobacco and spit, or worse, fisherman pee, will really turn a person off of trash. Really, the last thing I want to use is this garbage. And it can't even be recycled, most of it because it's not clean enough. I don't take anything from a beach for myself unless I've cleaned it first. It's a caregiving, land stewarding rule I have for myself. And so far, it's been a positive mutual understanding. So this has been a lot of methodology and history, but this next bit I'll share a few pieces from this exhibition as well as companion work that is either outside of the quilt form or currently in collections elsewhere. This in an attempt to provide a broader sense of my work. So these are the sister pieces that provided the title for this exhibition. Sample home number 1, which is the black one, is not in the exhibit because it was purchased by a collector in December, but I appreciate them here together since they were constructed simultaneously and hung together for months in my studio. They feel like a repetition of the same story in 2 genetically connected but different households. They are true sisters in that sense. Over the last 8 years, I've acquired a large collection of embroidered work and find the reverse sides of these embroideries intoxicating. To me, they represent the gritty underbelly no one was ever supposed to see. For those of you with a certain PTSD around embroidery, the kind that comes from childhood learning from an elder with a strict agenda, you'll understand when I repeat, the back is supposed to look as nice as the front, but it rarely does, and nor should it. It's one more unattainable perfection imposed upon us. This is like saying, hey, look, your house is burning down, but thankfully your stitches are all perfect. This is a piece called Shadow Self, which is pieced almost entirely from the reverse sides of these embroideries. The shadow in the title refers in part to the smeared ghost-like images made by these B-sides. You can see the obvious 1970s flower, but then there are the not so obvious 1980s big-headed babies. Some are messy, these backsides, some are pristine, but the shadow in the title also refers to the dark side of motherhood, the infra mundane that I mentioned before, the feelings you aren't supposed to feel if you're a good mother, and certainly aren't supposed to show. The hand applique words repeated here are mother and other. Societal structures will other you if you are a mother, but you are also othered if you are not a mother. This work in textiles takes on this duality. It occupies the reverse side, the shadow, where some of us question, what if I had children? But also the darker, what if I had not? Historically, an embroidery sample represented a young woman's skill and piousness, a confined space designated for practice and achieving perfection. The work kept girls busy but quiet, preparing them for the expected domestic role. My cutting apart, reassembling, and re-embroidering reinterprets the expectations placed on the original maker. Many embroideries arrived in my hands unfinished, with the needle often still embedded, where the maker just walked away. We've all done it. Not a failure, though, but a different kind of power. This story, or this piece called Girl's Story Number 2, is one in a series of three that provided an approach for how I was going to talk to my daughter about menarche when the time was right, with the intention of creating something more beautiful than the way it was brought to me. Those facts are dumped on most of us, really. The manner we are ushered into womanhood is hasty and confusing, generally uncelebrated, an insistence on sterility that competes directly with the muck of the moment. Some of us are taught that if we scrub and rinse hard enough, we can achieve perfection, even if this means removing the most fragile layers, even if it means leaving a hole. Girl Story Number 2 was made when my daughter was 5. She was too young to understand more than my absolute trust in her to guide this making process, and that we were making something important. We didn't know what it might become, but we were traveling together. And this was the narrative I wanted her to have first. I asked her to draw beautiful things, anything she wanted. And then I dipped a brush in ink and told her to place it on the heart of each image after I'd embroidered over the top of her drawings. And this could have gone wrong in so many ways, but it didn't. So the next two slides veer from two-dimensional wall work, and they aren't in this exhibition, but they represent companion work to the previous pieces. Motherhood is the subset of women's labor that continues to be the undercurrent of my work, particularly the emotions around failing and striving. 8 pounds, 4 ounces is a little heavier than an average newborn, but this work addresses a different weight. These stones are carefully swaddled, but also sutured, each one of them crowning and impossible to hold all at once without dropping some to the floor. Finding stones shaped so perfectly on beaches is the reminder of the fluid forces that shape the hardest and most remote parts of our bodies as well. For scale, those are my daughter's hands holding the largest stone, close to the actual size of a crowning skull. I work with multiples and repetition, whether it's forms or text. And despite what might seem like familiar shapes to us now, these are not a response to coronavirus. I actually started making these at the end of 2018 and made about a dozen over the course of a year. To me, they represent naval mines tethered in wait, or objects that seem benign until you stumble over them in the dark. They represent the kind of object lying around that someone will tidy up eventually, usually a caregiver, often me. I guess they were a harbinger of what 2020 would bring. The next works reference the body and what we hold on to. They represent the way I work with textiles and embeddedness, whether literal objects or emotion. So this piece considers the way we acquire language, specifically how we acquire the language of pain. When our children, and I have two children, were little, they started having all these aches and pains and talking about how their back hurt, or they had a headache, or they had a neck ache. And we realized that they were echoing the way that my husband and I were talking about our own bodies and the own way that we were feeling pain. So they were acquiring language from us, specifically the language of pain. It's something in our house that we refer to as hear you, hearing you, that constant modeling for children. Embedded in this piece are literal bones, rocks, coral, wood, and embedded text, litany. To read these texts without stopping literally sucks your breath out. The definition of a fatigue threshold is the amount of load a material or object can take before it fails or collapses. I spend a lot of time thinking about titles for work because I think they have to do a lot of work. This piece is about domestic labor, emotional labor, and abuse. It's a reimagining of a narrative I received about a woman who had crocheted a tablecloth while she was incarcerated for killing her abusive husband in the 1970s. I just received a scrap of that tablecloth, but that story really resonated with me. This is an exploration of her fatigue threshold, an empathic working towards understanding her emotions and what would have driven her to her actions. Spontaneous combustion is an earlier exploration of a fatigue threshold, but that of motherhood and that of my own. This piece was made after my son almost set the house on fire when he was 4 or 5, and then had to work through his fear by asking the same damn question every day for months. And I kept answering him, you know, the paper can catch on fire, the curtains can catch on fire, the carpet can catch on fire. But as he kept asking, I found myself getting darker and harder, saying things like, I could catch on fire and you could catch on fire. In the end, what he was really trying to understand was the concept of spontaneous combustion. And it took a long time for me to hear that that's what he needed to feel safe, was to understand that concept. And in the end, what I did realize, and what this piece is about, is that the thing in the house that was spontaneously combusting was me. This is the first piece of textile art I ever made, and it's still a touchstone for me. I think it's important to consider the power we wield. Those we care for are vulnerable, and there are many ways of reframing care. Even colonialism was considered care. And I also think about who has the power when working with textiles. Often they are the actors forcing me to change. I think with them, not just about them or how to change them. I'm always disappointed with the outcome when I've forced textiles to do something they've initially resisted. I spent 12 years in the garment industry. 9 of those were making custom wedding gowns, which afforded me a skill set that transferred into this kind of work. You also learn a lot about care in a fitting room when listening to a half-naked woman on the threshold of marriage. I don't approach quilts as quilts. Sometimes I don't even make quilts or think of them as quilts. I think of them as an alternative narrative form to process complicated feelings. River, for example, charts my disappearing menstrual cycle from 2010 to 2018, which was 10 years earlier than I had anticipated this would happen. My doctor had no answers, and neither did my mother. So I became my own witness as an attempt to understand all of those erratic, circled menstrual cycle lengths. It was a long process of watching, waiting, and responding. It was an act of self-care. The default communication around menopause is secrecy, embarrassment, dismissal, or trivialization. I chose to transform those days into a farewell, no matter how long it took, slicing into abandoned household linens and pinning them to the wall. The women who originally made this cloth remain unknown to me, but their collective female gaze still lingers. The name River refers to its length, over 20 feet long. But rivers also run dry, and they fill again. Rivers cut their way, and they rage. I come to this work with a lot of vulnerability. The techniques I use are old. A lot of them come from the garment industry. And while I spend a lot of time not knowing what I'm driving at conceptually, I generally know what I'm doing technically. Work often starts with an impulse or a feeling that over the course of hours and months shifts and changes. I emerge realizing that what I thought something was about is actually about something completely different, or they're actually layers of interconnected things. Materfamilias is the Latin word for matriarch. And many of us can recognize powerful women in our families who carry a kind of rage and judgment. I wonder about their own feelings of entrapment, discontent, and misunderstanding. And while we may flee from this history and those judgments that shaped us, the emotional residue is tough to slough off. We question our ability to mother, question our resilience, question our definitions of home. And I'm putting this definition up again because it's one that grounds me. It's something I keep returning to, especially during a pandemic and motherhood and not knowing. This last work is, in fact, a direct response to the coronavirus pandemic. A commissioned work for the Anchorage Museum for Future Ready, Survival Now and Next, which is a call for work that addresses survival essentials, anticipation of the inconceivable, and our association with place. I bundled my children in these sweltering Tyvek-lined suits and took them into the safest place possible. For us here in Alaska, the land, while shifting, uncertain, and in some cases endangered, still feels safe. As women, we salvage cloth, we salvage our relationships, we salvage ourselves. And through such acts, our bodies hold powerful but undervalued knowledge, despite personal and cumulative, distorted, or shifting memories. I see my work as the visual representation of the familiar acts of womanhood I know deeply, juxtaposed with an otherworldly wisdom I'm always left grasping for, the super mundane. My manipulation, repetition, and mark making is also practicing, telling a different story over and over, trying to get it right, and knowing it will never be perfect. So thank you so much for listening. And I'm super happy to take any questions you might have. Leslie, I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing my screen. Unless you want me to keep these up for a bit.
Oh, well, you know what? Thank you for putting that slide up. It enables us to once again say thank you to the organizations that help underwrite the costs of these textile talks. I am laughing and making fun of myself for saying welcome, I think probably to Tuesday talks, because we do a Tuesday talk series here at the museum. So thank you for those of you who pointed that out to me and gave me the opportunity to publicly acknowledge my error and correct it. So anyway, yes, thank you to those sponsors. And yeah, if you want to go ahead and stop sharing, that's fine. We can sure. Have a conversation and answer some of the questions. Somebody asked, how do you do the text in your piece? And we were looking at shadow self at that time. Maybe those, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, sure. So all of the text that I use is hand appliqued. And what I prefer to do is use wool and silk thread. And then I hand turn and hand applique the letters on. It's super time consuming. I've gotten really fast over the years because I've done it a number of times. But each letter takes about 20 minutes.
Wow, just for, yeah.
For reference. One of the pieces, fatigue threshold, the yellow one that says make the bed and make the bed and make the bed all the way around it. I thought, I'm going to blanket stitch this wool on, thinking that it would go so much faster. And each letter took 20 minutes. So it does better.
Well, but, at least you're consistent.
No, and I don't use, I prefer not to use glue on the work that I do, because I don't know how 50 years from now it will behave. And so my work does go into collections, and I want to be sure that there isn't something extra that a conservator has to worry about. And having dealt with a lot of old textiles, I have seen firsthand what, I'll give a couple of examples. Masking tape, which it's funny because I grew up embroidering, you know, that was the art that was in our house, was embroidering, and a lot of it were really inexpensive embroidery kits. So I have a soft spot for those. But I was talking to my mom about how, God, I keep getting these pieces of embroidery that have masking tape all around it. And 40, 50 years down the road, it's just crumbling and it's a mess, right? Yeah. And my mom said, you know, the instructions told you that you were supposed to put masking tape all the way around it to keep it from unraveling. Mm-hmm. And so between that and the other pieces that I've seen where people have actually fused interfacing onto the back of a piece of embroidery and trying to get that off is, it's a mess. It's tough, right? It's a chemical. Right. So it can do things like discolor and leave, you know, leave adhesives that just, they will never come off. So I have worked really hard to come up with a lot of ways of embedding objects and appliqueing, whether it's traditional applique, like those letters, or reverse applique, like the eyes that were inset into the piece, Matrifamilias. That's all reverse applique to get those eyes embedded in that piece.
And I appreciate you saying that you don't want to use tapes or adhesives or those things for conservation and stewardship purposes. As a museum, we can tell you that it really is a challenge for us.
Instead, I put things like bones.
You know, I mean,
deal with that.
Details. So, okay, we have some other great questions for you. There were a number of lace doilies. Were these originally white or off-white, or and then dyed, or what was that process?
Yeah, so the piece that perhaps they're referring to is the double-sided piece Cherry, that has they're kind of a sort of, they're more kind of an orangey rust, like a, they kind of look like a dried blood color,
right?
Which is what I was going for, like an ox blood. And those were all hand dyed. I think those were, you know, some of them were ecru colored and some of them were white. And then along with the linens that were used for the backside of that piece, it was all in the same dye vat, so sure, that it would be the same color. So I don't do a ton of dyeing. It's something that I'm just not really set up for. I've enjoyed the little bit of dyeing that I've done, but it does, I'm thinking always about water and what do I do now with, you know, this dye water, and, you know, it's,
right,
is it safe? Can I, where can I put it? Well, you know, so I just haven't quite wrapped my head around that. And natural dyeing is certainly exciting to me too, but it's kind of one more thing that I know myself, and I'm a learner. And so I get really excited about new things. And then I tend to like go down that path when really, I, you know, sometimes I just need to stay where I'm at and bump around inside the confines of the parameters that I've set for myself. So, those were dyed. There are other works that I've done that have used, just the colors of the doilies that came. And there's one piece that I didn't include in this slideshow that I wish I had now, because it does use multicolored, these really saccharine colors of crocheted flowers that had come. And I just, every time something would come that had these pastel colors, I just would stick it to the wall. And the next thing I knew, over the course of several months, there was this huge landscape on the wall of these crocheted flowers. And so that afforded me the opportunity to work with those as they were.
Sure. So we have about 13 questions posed to you to answer. Let's see if we can get through as many of these as possible. What do you mean by the term abandoned quilt?
So an abandoned quilt is a quilt that's either not been finished. So I have received over the course of the last few years, several, probably 8 to 10 quilt tops. They were just never finished.
Sure.
And then I've also received full quilts that people were either going to throw away or they didn't want anymore. And so to me, the word abandonment is, feels personal in terms of an object and in terms of a vulnerable object. And so not everything is going to go on to live another life. Sometimes it's the end of the road for things. That's just the way it is. But yeah, so that's what I'm referring to.
All right. How do you sort and keep your textiles?
Yeah, I feel like that is an ongoing process. And everything gets laundered, and the name of the paste that I use, ortho paste, is what I use to clean quilts and textiles. Is that the right term for it? Yeah, it's, I think it's used for cleaning horses also. Does that sound right, Leslie?
We don't wash and clean the quilts that come into our
clothes. I know you guys don't.
What the dye is or what might happen.
No, you have no idea. And that's the thing, right? It's these things have lived in people's homes. And so they have, you know, layers of smells going on, right? And so especially if it's a quilt top where there's no batting in between, it's really easy to clean those and hang them out and let them dry and get some sunshine. And then same with doilies and things. The other thing is, it depends on what it is. And sometimes I wash things hard and sometimes I don't. But if something's going to blow apart, I want it to blow apart in the laundry, not after I've spent hours working on something.
Sure.
Yeah.
What do you think, and this isn't even a millennial driven trend because we've seen it so often, it is ridiculous. It just keeps coming around. What do you think of the trend of cutting up vintage quilts to make coats from the perspective of your artistic practice?
Yeah, I've seen that. You know, I mean, I've cut up vintage quilts myself. I mean, I cut up vintage quilt tops and made pandemic suits that are lined with Tyvek.
I know, right? So fun, yeah.
So I don't. I'm absolutely not going to like poo-poo anybody's like impulses in that respect. So I would hope that if somebody is going to cut something up like that, that they accompany that object into the next phase of its life with an immense amount of respect.
Right, absolutely. Right.
Do not slap this coat or whatever it is that you are making next. Mm-hmm. Don't slap it together. Put it together with as much care and thought as the person who made it originally.
Right.
That's all I would ask. And whether that's going to happen or not is, you know, out of anybody's hands. But I think it's a responsibility that you have to the makers who came before you.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's also interesting to look, and this is part of your, I mean, this is what you do. It is that innate need to create and that vision when you look at something, that vision as to what it means to you, what it can become, what you see and imagine when you look at that, which can be very true, which I think it oftentimes is what's happening when designers take historic textiles and modify and change them. It's their vision. Those of people who are making quilts, of course, have, you know, different views and ideas about what that means as well. Okay, we have some more. We could talk about that all day long. somebody wanted to know if that is an industrial sewing machine behind you.
Yes, that is, yes, it's an Injuki, a Juki single needle industrial sewing machine. And I have an industrial iron as well.
Great.
I spent years in the clothing industry. So for me, that's the equipment that I was trained on was all industrial. And so I do have a domestic FAF that I've had since 1993, which has limped along all this time, but getting an industrial a few years ago was life altering and made me so happy.
Question, somebody says, your work shown today seems to address the dark side of women's life journey. What pieces do you have that address the joy?
So I feel like all of the work that I do explores that duality, right? So there is absolute beauty in the way that I construct things and the care that goes into them and the time that I put into them and the thought. But I think it's important to, for me, at least right now, to tell stories that have been marginalized, that weren't heard or weren't listened to or no one cared about and no one felt like they could talk about. I think it's for the next generation of change makers and people who we want to see make a difference in this world. They need to know what all of those stories are, because I'll just say this, the patriarchy has kept it from the center of the conversation. So, you know, having a discussion with my daughter about menarche in a way that reframed it and made it beautiful, that's what she has inside of her now. Mm-hmm. And whether someone sees that piece and understands it or not, that's not really that important, but to me, it's a beautiful piece, and that is absolutely an example of the beauty of womanhood and a mother-daughter relationship.
You bet. Will you before we move on, a couple people have asked about whether you have a book or a blog or those sorts of things. Can you tell people what your website is so that they can find, you have a blog on there, you have some things, you have artist statements, beautiful photos of your work. Would you take a minute and share your web address with us?
Sure. Yeah, it's so easy. It's amymeisner.com, and that's amymeisner.com. I'm not really on Facebook much, but I am on Instagram. And so that Instagram handle is at amymeisnerartist.
Here's an interesting question, which I think you kind of touched on it a little bit as you were visiting and explaining your work and in the answer to your question. How has your work influenced your children or your family?
I think that's a great question. And there's such a duality there. Like, I wouldn't be doing the work that I'm doing if I hadn't had children. I'd be doing something really different. And for that, I'm really grateful. So I see it in my children. My daughter in particular is a very proficient seamstress. She's 12. She's one of those people who can look at something and figure out how it's made. Mm-hmm. Which is really exciting because she also has a really scientific brain as well. And my husband is an architect. And while the kids, especially now, see him working from home, which is really boring, just looking at a computer, they have also had the opportunity to build models with him. Mm-hmm. And my son learned how to use the sewing machine when he was really young. He knows how to embroider. He knows how to knit. And to have him take those haptic skills and apply them to like a bicycle and take the whole bicycle apart and put it all back together again. Like, I know that it's that kind of tinkering that they're seeing us doing all the time and will allow them to just have a much broader sense of the way that things work and the way that things go together and have a much deeper appreciation for the way things are built. I also think that the time that we spend every summer in Prince William Sound cleaning beaches, like that's what they know. And so I know that will influence them for the rest of their lives, for sure.
Sure, that's great. Somebody asked, when you sew stones into your hanging quilts, do they not pull the quilt out of shape? Or how do you stabilize that when the quilt is hanging to maintain your design integrity?
Yeah, I mean, this is the big challenge, right? Mm-hmm. To figure out how to make that happen. And so if you were to do an archaeological dig inside of my quilts, you would find like a structure inside that is made with other fabric and stitching. None of it's glued or anything like that. But that is what stabilizes everything. So that piece, Cherry, that's really heavy, each one of those yo-yos has a structure inside of it, not just the stone. And then they are the way that they're sewn together, the way that the border is created and the way that the mounting mechanisms mm-hmm. Are installed, all of these things work together.
Okay.
To keep them from sagging and drooping. And so I spend a lot of time on the architecture of a quilt, and I think about them as I would think about a garment. And I think all of that time making wedding gowns and making corsets and working with boning and all of those things, these are all skills that that are directly used in quilt making for me.
Yeah, it's when one is creating, right? they are taking what they know inherently and what they can imagine to do that. And that is one of the beauties with quilt art, textile art, fiber art, fiber surface design, any of that is the layers literally that come to bring it together to create what we see in our minds. We have time for just a couple more questions.
Sure.
A couple people have asked about what took you to Alaska and how living in that environment has informed your process and your art.
Yeah, so we came here in 2020. Mm-hmm. And we'd been living in Vancouver, British Columbia. That's where I was in the clothing industry. I was approaching 30 at that time and knew that I didn't want to be in that industry anymore. I had been in it since I was 17. I'd worked in small factories and small ateliers doing wedding gowns, but it was a lot. I knew that that wasn't something that I wanted to do once I had children.
Mm-hmm.
I also wanted to go back to school. And so it's just, if somebody had told me you're going to live in Alaska, I would have laughed at them because that was not in the plan. But yeah, my husband's an architect. He ended up getting a job with a firm here. And then I was accepted into a creative writing MFA program at the University of Alaska Anchorage. And it just kind of came together. So that's what brought us here. And we stayed because it's kind of an incredible place to live.
Right.
It is really far away from family, which is hard. That's super hard, especially once we had children. Phenomenal place to raise kids though, just with regards to them being, like they are outside right now, they're home doing Zoom stuff, but Wednesdays are their day off and they're out somewhere in the backyard in the snow,
right?
Whatever it is that they're doing. And what it has done is it has set just like a really high threshold for beauty for them. So it's not going to matter where they go. They will always have that touch point as to what nature and the natural world, what it does for them. So
wonderful. Yeah, they'll carry it with them forever. I want to clarify, you arrived in Alaska in 2020.
Sorry, I think I said 2020. Is that what I said? It's 2000.
Yeah, it's kind of like Tuesday talks when really it's textile talks.
It was like just last week I got here. No, 2000, sorry.
2000, all right.
20, I think is seared on the brain. Like
it is.
Maybe
it
forever.
It is. I see our time is up and we've just had some tremendous questions. Again, this program has been wonderful. Thank you so much, Amy.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Leslie.
It is recorded and will be available later to review. I wanted to again say thank you, Amy, for joining us. Thank you to the textile organizations and that we all partner with to provide these programs each week. Speaking of which, next week, the San Jose Museum of Quilts and Textiles will present Creative Continuity with Joe Cunningham. So very fun. He's always a delight to talk to. So we hope that y'all can join us for that as well. And we wish everyone good health and we'll see everyone next week. Thank you again, Amy. Thank you everyone who attended. We appreciate it.
Safe, everyone.